أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه تسليما كثيرا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Usually, Ikhwani, when I come to this masjid for the Salat of Al-Jum'ah, I get dropped off in front of the office from Green Lane, and I come through Green Lane, so I don't get an opportunity to see the coming and the going of the people to the masjid. But today, I came from the way of Morrison's, and walking from the Morrison car park to the masjid, I saw the people walking to the masjid, and it just reminded me that the day of the Jummah is one of those occasions when the reality of the madahir of al-Islam is going to be clearly shown to the Muslims themselves and people who are not Muslims. I didn't mean to talk about this at all. It was just an observation that I made, that I had. Similar to that observation is when this Mu'adhin begins to do the adhan for the day of Al-Jum'ah, the person who is sitting in that audience, if he knows about the ahkam of Al-Jum'ah and he knows about the ahkam of the Salat in general, then he knows concerning the adhan of the Salat, whether it's Jum'ah other than that, there are a lot of rewards for the person if he repeats what the Mu'adhin says, and then after that he makes a dua that the Prophet said about it sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Anyone who makes that dua, I will get shifa. He will get my shifa on yawm al-qiyamah. He has six types of intercession. I didn't come to talk about that. He had six types of intercession yawm al-qiyamah. He'll be able to intercede for those Muslims who will be in the hellfire and they'll be burning. And he'll get involved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he'll get them out of the hellfire. He'll have the ability to get and give intercession for the person who deserves to go into the hellfire. He deserves to go into it. But he'll get involved and he'll step in and he'll say, don't put him in there. He'll make intercession with Allah Azza wa Jalla for those two categories of people. But they're not any Amr, Bakr, and Zaid from the people. They're the people who make that dua after the adhan. They're the people who say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on him, especially on Friday. They're the people who want to spread his sunnah, be upon his sunnah. They're the people who, they raise him up higher and big in their minds and their hearts more than anyone else from the creation. The government, the family, the tribe, another masjid, he doesn't care. If all of the non-Muslims, all of the governments came together to try to put the personality of Rasulullah down, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that individual is going to push back that attempt with what is appropriate. He's not going to backslide. He's not going to be afraid. So the point here is, the Muslim wants to get the reward of the Jum'ah prayer, and there are many. Then he has to learn about the Jum'ah prayer. What to do, what not to do, how to do it, how not to do it, where to sit, where not to sit, how to come to get the seat, and so forth and so on. And then what to do after the Jum'ah prayer. And that's every single week. Now we come to an issue, which is the season, and this is the topic of the discussion. This is the season of one of the most important aspects of the madahir of al-Islam. The manifestations of al-Islam, like on Friday, Muslims walk into the masjid from every direction, whatever country they find themselves in, that's from the manifestation. Those are Muslims, it's part of their religion. They do that every single week. Now we are coming, inshallah, about to embark upon one of the most important seasons during the course of not the year, but the life of an individual. And that's the blessed month of Ramadan and all that it entails and all that it contains. So in the last Jummah, before the Ramadan begins, I want to remind you people of two issues. And I already know that many of you, especially those of you who are keen on worshiping Allah with knowledge, those people who are trying to make this a special Ramadan, a better Ramadan, I know many of you have been making preparations already in terms of studying what you need to know. Because Ramadan is a situation that no matter how much you know in this religion, and no matter how many Ramadans you have fasted, there are always many things to know. The iftar, breaking your fast at Maghrib time, just breaking your fast, what to break it on, how to break it, what to say, what not to do, when to do it. It has a lot of ahkam. It by itself takes a lesson or two. What about the suhoor? What about some of the ahkam connected to the traveler, connected to the sick, connected to the elders, and connected to so many other issues? Ramadan is a golden opportunity for an individual to get into that Jannah. That companion of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Sufyan, he came and he asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, dulluni ala amalin adkhulu bihil Jannah. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alayka bis-sawm fa inna la mathila lahu. Ya Rasulullah, guide me to something. Give me some advice. I need some advice. Guide me to some action that I can do. By that action, I can get into the Jannah. Out of all of the things that he could have said, there were many. He could have told him, Ya Abdullah ibn Sufyan, it's important for you to help to establish the Khilafah in the earth. And the Khilafah here is to establish the way that Allah wants to be worshipped and how He wants people to be governed. Not the Khilafah that's just empty slogans and kalam. It's important in Islam, the establishment of the Khilafah, but he didn't mention that. He could have mentioned to that man, with all of the virtues of a jihad, jihad in Islam, the real jihad in Islam, that as a Muslim, Abu Usama, I cannot allow any government, any group of people, Muslims, non-Muslims, jinn, I can't allow them to make me become apologetic. I can't be too rough to the right. I want to kill everybody, blow everything up. I'm crazy. I can't be like that. And also, I can't be to the other extreme, the apologetic one, who wants to come and change the complexion of al-Islam. He could have told Abdullah ibn Sufyan about, hey, you make jihad, you want to go to Jannah, the ultimate sacrifice. Again, Ikhwani Ummat al-Islam, the jihad of al-Islam, rules and regulations. The jihad of Islam has been legislated to save lives. The jihad of al-Islam has been legislated for safety and security. The jihad of al-Islam has been legislated in order to overpower the kalimatul batil by the kalimatul haq. As for our young people, our youngsters, and other than them, the jihad is not you going to Syria, not you going to Syria. And then when you go to Syria, your mother, who didn't know that you went to Syria, has to get on BBC News. She has to get on one of those channels, and she has to plead with you to come back because you're her only son. And she says to you, Allah is not going to be happy with you because I didn't want you to go over there. You didn't get permission from me to go over there. And I'm not even talking, Ikhwani, about what's in the land of Syria. I'm not even talking about the fighting that's going on. I'm not talking about that. That's another issue, that fitna and drama. What I'm talking about is, you didn't get permission from your mother to go to that place. So that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling that man, hey, Abdullah ibn Sufyan, if you want to do something that will get you into the Jannah, then I tell you, you should fast. For verily, there is nothing that is comparable to fasting. There is nothing that is similar to fasting, Abdullah ibn Sufyan. So from the wisdom of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that out of all of the things he could have guided that man to and advised that man with, he advised him with fasting and described it as being something that it has no parallel. Nothing is similar to it. We are upon that season right now. This is a golden opportunity for an individual to get into the good books with Allah Azza wa Jal. Even those individuals have gone overboard. They went overboard in oppressing themselves and making mistakes. People who didn't fast a number of times during the course of their lives. This is an opportunity. A new Ramadan is an opportunity for him or her to get countless amounts of rewards. And at the end of those rewards is the Jannah that Allah Ta'ala has prepared specifically for people who fast. For people who fast. So concerning that issue, Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned in the Quran, Ikhwani, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, some special rewards and awards for the people who fast correctly. And there are many ayat concerning that. From the ahadith, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam first described for us that Jannah. He said about that Jannah, إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطْرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ أَحَدٍ. In that paradise, Abdullah, is what no eyes of the human beings have ever seen. No eyes at all, whether human or other than human. That's a general statement. Malaika, the jinn in that Jannah, is what no eyes have ever seen. Only Allah knows what's in there, and what no ears have ever heard of, and it has never been imagined or contemplated by any human being. They don't have the ability to contemplate what Allah has put in that Jannah. Someone in this masjid right now, from amongst us, he may live in Edgbaston, and he may live in one of these other upper posh areas. Allahu alam. Someone here has the nicest house in this city of Birmingham, and someone has the nicest house back where we come from. A massive house that's clean with beautiful furniture. The Nabi says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Mawdi'u sultan fil jannah khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha." The one whip that the man uses to ride his animal, the one whip that he makes his animal go fast, go to the right, go to the left, he said, if you put that whip in the Jannah, the space that that whip occupies, that small space is better than the Jannah and everything that is in the Jannah. So some of us who don't have the nicest houses, we've seen some beautiful houses on TV and we've seen them from outside. That small whip is better than that. The occupant of that nice house in this dunya, he may be wretched. He may be majnoon. Not majnoon clinically, but the way he's living, he's not happy. You have the opportunity with this fast in Ramadan to get a house that's better than that in the Jannah. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam used to on the Friday, every Friday, he used to on the Eid day recite those ayat to the community in which Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned those descriptions of the Jannah, and they are so many. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned in the Quran, وَبَشِّرَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِيَ الْأَنْهَارِ كلما رزقوا من ثمرة الرزق قالوا هذا الذي رزقنا من قبل وأتوا به متشابها ولهم فيها أزواج مطهرة وهم فيها خالدون. يا محمد, give glad tidings to those people who believe and they do righteous deeds. They believe in Allah with Tawheed. They're afraid of only Allah Azza wa Jal. Their individuals don't have khurafat and shirk and bid'ah in what they believe. They don't do magic. They don't say hazir nazir. They don't say that the Nabi knows the ilm al-ghayb. They don't make dua to the dead people. They don't swear by other than Allah. They don't swear for other than Allah. They have tawheed. Give them glad tidings. And the ones who do good deeds, from those good deeds is they fast in the month of Ramadan. What are those good deeds? Are those good tidings? That they're going to have not Jannah, but Jannat, under which rivers flow. They'll be provided therein, and they'll get some things that were similar to the dunya. When they receive some of those things, they're going to say, this is similar to what we used to have in the dunya. And from what they'll get that similar are some wives who are pure. Azwajun mutahara. They will be in there forever. That's their reward. So the hadith said, no eyes have ever seen what's in that Jannah. No ears have ever heard it. No eyes have ever seen it. It wasn't imagined by any human being. But some of the things are similar in the names. Some of the things are similar in some of how it looks. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, inna fil jannati bahrul ma wa bahrul asal wa bahrul laban wa bahrul khamar thumma tashakuku anhar min ba'd. Verily, when the people go into the Jannah, they're going to see that there's going to be a big ocean of water. They know what water is in the dunya. They're going to have a big ocean of water that they're going to see. And then they're going to see a big ocean of honey. I saw honey in a cup. I saw honey in a glass, one of those bottles that you buy water in. I saw honey in that. I never saw honey that was like an ocean. I never saw that. They're going to see the oceans made out of honey. And they're going to see the oceans made out of milk. They know what milk is, leaven. But that leaven is different. No one ever saw an ocean of leaven. No one ever saw that. Leaven that doesn't spoil after so many days. And in that Jannah is an ocean of khamr, sharab. Khamr that doesn't make people drunk. I never saw an ocean of khamr. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the people witness that, then the anhar of al-Jannah are going to start to flow before them. And they are going to get a massive amount of reward and gratitude and appreciation just for seeing those visuals. So they'll be given things over there that are not the same, but they're similar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned about the women that were mentioned in that ayat. قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَوْ أَنَّ إِمْرَأَةً مِنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ أَشْرَقَتْ لَمَلَأَتِ الْأَرْضِ رِيحَ مِسْكٍ وَلَأَذْحَبَتْ بِدَوْءِ الشَّمْسِ وَالْقَمَرِ. Those women that were mentioned in that ayat, that the non-Muslims come and take these ayat out of context, so many of them. And the Muslim can't apologize. He can't be of the people too far to the right, and he has a warped, crazy idea of what these things are talking about, because there are people who believe that if he does something crazy, he's going to get some women from Jannah. You're not going to get women from Jannah when you do crazy things in this religion. You don't get rewarded in this religion for doing crazy things. There's no reward for someone doing something crazy. The Sheikh is an old man. He's an older person. May Allah Ta'ala give our shayukh a lot of health and longevity in their lives. I want to do something good for the deen, and I do the wrong thing to the old man, believing, hey, I'm going to get rewarded for that. So we don't want to be from those people on the extreme, nor do we want to be from the other people who are apologetic, who, when people don't believe in Allah and His Messenger, people who don't know about al-istinja, people themselves are lower than some of the animals in the way that they behave and they exist. People are not fair and just. When they have something to say, here comes that Muslim apologizing. Just be in the middle, Abdullah. That's our dua, ihdina sirat al-mustaqim, every day. Just be in the middle. Don't be from those people, and don't be from those people, because both extremes are a problem. You have a problem with those people, we have a religious responsibility to have a problem with the mutashaddideen. But we also have a religious responsibility to be equally upset with the apologetic individual. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the balanced Muslims that if that woman from al-Jannah, if she were to simply look at the dunya, just look at the dunya, then as a result of that, she would fill up the whole dunya with the nicest smelling misk fragrance. And if she was to just look at the dunya, she's going to put out and extinguish the light of the sun and the light of the moon. The person who believes in the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, part of his iman in the hereafter, it necessitates that. So the point here, ikhwani, the point here is, Allah has prepared this Jannah for the people who fast in the month of Ramadan. And in that Jannah are amazing issues. That's what's behind the Jannah. It's not about, that's what's behind the fast. It's not about leaving your food and your drink only. It's about an individual seeing before Ramadan begins, inshallah. This is an opportunity, Abdullah. This is an opportunity, as Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, Innal Abrara. He said in the Quran, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, concerning the Jannah, Innal Abrara yashrabuna min ka'sin kana mizajuha kafura, aynan yashrabu biha ibadullahi yufajjirunaha tafjira. The Abrar, the scholar said, they're the people who fast. They are the people as well, but they are the people who fast. Out of all of the things that we can mention concerning fasting, the one thing I want to remind this community of today, is that fasting has a lot of things that we have to do. I want to encourage you to be of those people who really, in this month of Ramadan, try to be of the people who are giving food to the people who are needy of that food. Whether they're your relatives, whether it's the local masjid, whether it's all of those masharir, all of those projects that are going on that you're going to see, because you get emails asking you, donate to this, feeding poor people, needy people. In this masjid, your local masjid, some masjid across town, in London somewhere, for you to feed an individual, for you to feed an individual, and to break his fast, and the deen of Allah is from the best issues in Al-Islam and in the month of Ramadan. You will not find another group of people, other than the Muslims, being more generous when it comes to feeding than the Muslims. And the reason for that is feeding people is a part of Al-Iman. Feeding people is a part of the proof that a person believes in Yawmul Qiyamah. And that's why Allah asks the question in the Quran, أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا يَحُدُّ عَلَى الطَّعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. Do you want to see the one who disbelieves in Yawmul Deen? He's the one who's nasty to the yatim, to the orphan. He's the one who does not encourage the feeding of the miskeen. Yawmul Qiyamah, those kuffar, the people will be in the hellfire. They will be asked the question, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ قَالُوا لَن نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ وَلَمْ نَكُنْ نُطْعِمُ الْمِسْكِينَ وَكُنَّا نَخُوضُ مَا خَائِدِينَ وَكُنَّا نُكَذِّبُ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ. Hey, you people, what wound you up? How did you end up in the hellfire in the sakr? Why are you there? The answer, we are those people who didn't pray. We are those people who didn't feed the miskeen. And we used to disbelieve in the Yawm al-Din. So feeding in this religion is from the best issues. Revert. I'm not saying that Christians and Jews, and I'm not saying white people, Europeans, and other Africans, that they don't take care of the daif, that they don't spend and give food. I'm not saying that. But no group of people, no ummah does it like Islam, like the Muslims. And one of the benefits that the revert is going to get is when he comes into this religion and he meets Muslims from wherever they are, he's going to see that in them. The man comes to work for the Muslim in his house. He's a non-Muslim. He comes, he's a Sikh Hindu. He comes as an electrician. When it's time for lunch, the Muslim's going to give him some food. He's going to make some tea for him. That's part of his religion. So in the month of Ramadan, Ikhwani, you want to get some rewards, then Allah Ta'ala has prepared the Jannah for those people who feed. The Nabi, he mentions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna fil jannati ghurafa yura zahiruha min batiniha wa batinuha min zahiriha a'addaha Allahu liman at'am at-ta'am. Verily, in the Jannah there are some lofty towers that are beautiful. The Prophet described those towers. He said, as he mentioned in another hadith, inna al-jannah mi'at ad-daraja ma bayna kulli darajatayn kama bayna as-sama'i wal-ard. In the Jannah, it is 100 levels. 100. That's what we know. In the Jannah, it has a smell. The companions say, Ya Rasulullah, what is the Jannah made from? What is it made from? He told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Bina'ul Jannah min labina min fidda wa labina min dhahab. Wa milatuha al-misk al-adhfar. Wa hasba'uha al-lu'lu wal-yaqut. Wa tarbatuha al-za'faran. What is Jannah made of, Ya Rasulullah? He said, the Jannah, it is built out of gold bricks and silver bricks. And the mortar, the cement that connects those bricks, it is made out of mist that is adfar, the best mist during their time. And he said about the Jannah that the Jannah's fragrance can be smelled from 40 years away. The lady who has bad akhlaq, she won't smell the Jannah, although its fragrance can be smelled from 40 years away. The man who kills someone who there's a contract with him, he kills someone unjustly, he won't smell the Jannah even though it can be smelled 40 years away. So many issues. He said in that Jannah, the rocks, the pebbles, everywhere there are pebbles, everywhere. He said that those pebbles are made out of yaqut and lu'lu, pearls and rubies. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the ground, the dirt of the Jannah is made out of za'faran. Saffron that people cook with. But there ain't no cooking with that in the Jannah. The point is, ikhwati fillah, the Prophet said in that Jannah, Allah has made lofty places for those who feed people food. For those people who feed people food, outside of Ramadan, inside of Ramadan, they feed people food. He said in the Quran, ikhwani, in Surah Al-Insan, and for those who don't know, from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Surah Al-Insan is a surah he used to read every Friday, the Muslims are hearing this, for Salatul Fajr, every Friday, they hear that, every Friday. Why did he choose that? And inside of that surah is what Allah Ta'ala has prepared for the people who give food. Over 20 benefits, 20 rewards for giving someone food. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمٍ عَبُوسًا قَمْتَرِيًا فَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ وَلَقَّاهُمْ نَضْرَةً وَسُرُورًا وجزاهم بما صبروا جنة وحريرا متكئين فيها على الأرائك لا يرون فيها شمسا ولا قمترير ولا زهر ولا قمترير. All of those ayat, ikhwani, more than that, clear indication that the person gets a lot of reward. So in concluding, those of you who have not fasted in the past, don't follow that stuff that we hear from the madhab. Don't follow that stuff that we grew up from the Asian community. I became a Muslim. When I became a Muslim with some of those agents, they told me about the prayers I had to make that are connected to the salats. Salatul Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. There were about 1,000 prayers they told me I had to make. Do this one and that. And then when you come and you find out it's not that many, then it gets worse. The individual didn't pray. He didn't pray. So now the mufti, someone tells him, the mawvi tells him, you have to make up all of those prayers that you didn't pray for the last 10 years. It's impossible for you to know that. The way you get through that, inshallah, is by feeding people if you missed Ramadan. The Prophet mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من فطر الصائم فكان له مثل أجره إلا لا ينقص أجر الصائم شيئا. Anyone who breaks the fast of a faster, he will get the reward of his fast without that fast being depleted one bit. So if you provide Abdullah the water, if you provide the date, if you provide something, people break their fast, 2,000 people, 3,000 people, 100, you'll get 100 rewards of fasting. The Prophet said, Yawm al-Qiyam, Allah will look into the salat. He'll say to the Malaika, what's the deal with the salat of my slave? If he completed it, it will be written down as complete. If he didn't complete those prayers, he missed a lot. Allah will say, look at the tatawwu' of my slave. Look at his nawafil. And take those nawafil and complete what he messed up on the fard. And then he said, وَتُؤْخِذُ الْأَعْمَالَ عَلَى ذَلِكُمْ. And all of the deeds will be like that. Look at the soul of my slave. Did he do it right? If he did it right, it's written correct. If he didn't do it wrong, then add on to the nawafil. From the nawafil, shawwal. From the nawafil, Monday, Thursday. From the nawafil, break someone's fast. And that doesn't mean, ikhwani, that you are an individual who has to give a big meal. Just bring some dates to a masjid. Just buy some water for the people in the masjid. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ونسأل الله تعالى أن يوفقنا وإياكم لأن نبلغ رمضان ويبلغنا على الخير وعافية. From the virtues of Ramadan, ikhwani, is the hadith of the man who, he had a brother. One of them died and the other one died a year after him. The one that died first, the people were praising that individual. The companions were praising him. And Allah's Prophet said, "Antum shuhada'ullahi fil ard." You, when you speak good about something or someone, you are Allah's witnesses. They praised that brother who died first. And then the other brother who died the next year, the Prophet said, "What about him?" They say, "Ya Rasulullah, that first brother was this, he was that, he was that." He said, "Yeah, but you know what? That second brother, he lived one more extra year and he fasted a Ramadan that the other one didn't fast." This is a golden opportunity. A golden opportunity for the individual to get some rewards. And not just some rewards, but to get that stuff that we messed up on in the past, get that stuff wiped away. And also to receive, inshallah, and to get some of those jannat. The Prophet said about the Jannah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Inna jannata aqrab ila ahadikum min shirat na'lihi." The Jannah is closer to one of you, closer than his own shoe, his shoestring. It's close to you, it's close to his shoestring. All you gotta do is give some money and help someone to break his fast. Which brings me to the end of this khutbah. We have some revert brothers in this religion. This is going to be their first fast. They fast in 18 hours in the month of Ramadan. Reverts from who were Sikhs, Hindus, black, white, Chinese in this masjid. This is the time, Ummat al-Islam, to take care of those people. 18 hours, his first fast. He wasn't like you. He wasn't like me. He went through a cycle of different fasts, long hours, short hours, 18 hours. And then the jihad of getting home and all of that stuff. We have to make it our business to pull those people in and say, come and eat with me today. We have to make it our business. We have other brothers who are not reversed. People from Morocco, people from Somalia, people came here from Algeria, other places. They live in shared accommodations. People were students and other than that. This is the time to try to make these people feel the mazahir of al-Islam, the brotherhood, the sisterhood of al-Islam. Those of you who are mothers, this is your jihad right now. This is the jihad of cooking for people and helping people. This is a golden opportunity, Ummat al-Islam, to feed those people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put under our responsibility and our supervision. With that being the case, this masjid, we have a food bank that is going to kick off tomorrow. Food bank. What's a food bank? That's you bringing all of your foodstuffs that you don't use. Things that are in your cabinets and your cupboards that are spoiling. They're just there. They're window dressing. That's it. Bring that stuff to the masjid, inshallah azzajal. Bring your money to the masjid and give freely from that food. Give from what Allah Ta'ala has given you with the need and in the hope. This is for the purpose of breaking people's fast. This is for the purpose of trying to get some of the reward that Allah Ta'ala mentioned concerning fasting. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from all of the fitting that would take us away from the true fasting of Islam. That Allah ta'ala makes the Quran more beloved to us in this month than watching the World Cup. That Allah ta'ala makes us of those people who have a bigger concern than watching a bunch of guys running around in short pants kicking a ball. Because the Muslim is higher than that. Inna Allah yuhibbu ma'ali al-amur wa yakru sifsafaha. Allah loves that you preoccupy yourself with high, exalted things. And he hates it that you preoccupy yourselves with little things. In the month of fasting, who has to fast? The Muslim who is baligh, who is aqil, the one who is qadir, the one who is muqim. Baligh, your children who are 15 years old, your children who hair has come out of them, they have to fast. Baligh. Those companions, radiallahu anhum, their children used to come. The boy come. Ya Rasulullah, I want to go with you in jihad of Badr. Rasulullah say, no. No, you can't go. He was 14. Next year, Badr. He said, I want to go with you to Badr. It's hot, it's fast. I want to go. He looked at him. The boy was 15. The Nabi said, okay, let's go. So once he gets 15, she gets 15, she's bound it. Got to fast. What's the point? The little boy is preoccupied with going to Badr, going to Uhud. He's not preoccupied with kicking a rock around, kicking a ball around. That's not the way of the Muslim. So may Allah Ta'ala accept it from us and you, and may he make us of those people who are from the Ansar of the Sunnah, and may he forgive all of us, inshallah, before Ramadan and give us the real reward and the blessings of Ramadan. Aqimus Salat, yarhamakumullah. Humaira, Humaira, don't forget to bring that syrup. Humaira. Naeem, can you come to the front, inshallah, after the salah, to the office? Naeem, can you come to the office after the salah? And also Zimbabwe, Zimbo.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله استووا واعتدلوا يرحمني ويرحمكم الله الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم
مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين قل الحمد لله وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى الله خير أما يشركون أمن خلق السماوات والأرض وأنزل لكم من السماء ماء فأنبتنا به حدائق ذات بهجة ما كان لكم أن تنبتوا شجرها أإله مع الله بل هم قوم يعدلون الله سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى الله أكبر